sure there would be an enlightening session today, and we go back not just with an inspiration to mull over the subject, but also be active to do something to build a research in India. Thank you.
Amen. And also delighted to be here this evening, thanks to the invitation from Swami Vivekananda and Dr. Balasubramanian, or to all of you.
I am grateful
to the Deputy Commissioner who has first taken up this function.
These are time.
Testing many, including politician servants. You have, I can go there. You are in India?
You are in America,
my place. Crossroads in this country. India can be proud of many things. One of the heroes of Indian social movement, or Indian social and spiritual movement, Swami Vivekananda has been honored today. It is very nice of Dr. Balasubramanian and his team to think of seeing the lectures to pay tribute to this great son of India, who wanted India to be powerful not only politically, but also spiritually. We are a nation about which all of us need to be proud of our heritage. This is a land where truth and honor and valor and dharma were worshipped as the cardinal principles of existence. Unfortunately, we are now a nation of a weak-willed compromisers, of leaders unable to lead, of rampant corruption and endemic faithlessness. Our democratic leaders are gambling with democracy. We suit ourselves with lullabies of ancient history and great leaders, but are we entitled to call worthy successors of such great personages in this country? When Lord Macaulay visited India, he made the following observation: I have travelled across the length and breadth of India, and I have not seen one person who is a beggar, who is a thief. Such wealth I have not seen in any other country. Such high moral values, people of such caliber, that I do not think we would ever conquer this country unless we break the very backbone of this nation, which is our spiritual and cultural heritage. And therefore, I propose that we replace our old and ancient educational system, our culture, for if the Indian scheme, all that is foreign and English is good and greater than their world, and they will lose their self-esteem, their native culture, and they will become what we want them, a truly dominated nation. Unfortunately, Macaulay's remedy seems to have worked, and we seem to have lost the rich heritage that we can claim to belong. Today I am asked to talk about the electoral reforms and the political corruption, or corruption in general, which is affecting the quality of our democracy. When we celebrated the Golden Jubilee of Indian democracy, the chairman of the UPA, she mentioned, she addressed us and the nation in 19 made a statement. I think we should all know how important it is to have electoral reforms. 2001. I would not be detracting from the occasion when I draw attention to the need for electoral reforms. The Election Commission itself has been making recommendations on this subject from time to time. I want to reiterate my personal commitment and that of the party that I lead to strengthening the electoral process in a comprehensive manner. I see that we have talked enough on electoral reforms. The time for concrete action is now, and we stand prepared to make our contribution. This was in the year 2001. Today we are in 2012. We do not seem to see any action towards electoral reforms. We have been suggesting number of proposals for bringing about changes in the electoral system. While we are really proud that our electoral procedure has received international recognition and acclamation, our democracy seems to begin and end with the electoral system or electoral process. What we need is good quality democracy with quality representatives in all our legislatures, both at the state and the center. Until recently, I don't know whether many of you have attended the parliament or not, I have attended in 50s, 60s and 70s. The caliber of our parliamentarians used to be extraordinarily good. All of them had a national outlook. Unfortunately, over a period of time, this national outlook seemed to have withered away. Whether it is state politics or central politics, you find politicians are not as nationalistic as they used to be. Here again, I quote Justice B.R. Krishnaiya. He wrote an article sometime in 1990, Salvaging Democracy. India of the 20th century, as stressed by Gandhar Mitha, is a soft state, and its developmental and administrative machinery stagnant and corrupt. The pervasive political delinquency of massive slush money, hush money, and spoiled system is raging in geometrical progressions. When you measure the democratic content and quality of our social order, do remember our failures, which if not remedied, may lead us to the limbo of authoritarianism, apathy, and decadence. These grave shortcomings which affect our nature are corrosive corruption, denial of decentralization and pluralism in the power processes, the culture of deliberation, the seeping insensitivity of human rights, and the conquering heroism of vulgar hedonism, at once omnipresent and omnipotent. So we are in the midst of a situation when the nation is going through very critical times, and the quality of democracy is gradually deteriorating. If you look at the newspaper or the TV channel, you find people are not tolerant to others' views. One of the essential ingredients of a good quality democracy is tolerance. You are not able to tolerate others' views, whether it is individual or a society or a caste or a community. We do not know how to respect others. Today, in fact, in the morning we were discussing how is it that in Western democracies function in a more disciplined manner than in the Oriental democracies. So one of the things that came to our discussion was essentially Indians are individualistic. We have always been, our leaders have stressed the quality of individual perspective. Somehow the societal obligations were not noted. I don't say that they were not there. In fact, the religion says that everyone should be happy. Sarva jana sukhino bhavantu. ignored, and everyone seems to be perfecting the individual person rather than the quality of social life. If you look at the pages of history, some of the Maharajas, some of the rulers of India were more democratic than the rulers who are sitting in our legislatures. They had the quality of listening to others. I can, in fact, a number of research work saying that they used to follow the guild system and follow the advice of the guild leaders. Shivaji had a famous council, Ashtapradhan Mantri Mandal. So they had the benefit of consulting others, listening to people's voices, and they carried on. But we do not seem to have that kind of democratic structure today. Mr. Edmund Burke once made an observation when he addressed the citizens of Bristol. He said, please select such leaders for your constituency who will represent your constituency interest first. But if there is a conflict between constituency interest and the national interest, please select only such leaders who will opt for national interest. But today, if you look at our legislatures, you will find many of the legislators are keen to promote a particular section of community, a section of social interest, rather than promoting the national interest as a whole. I'm not saying that all of them are bad, but many of them are. We need to improve the quality of our elected representatives. And for that purpose, we need electoral reforms. What are the important electoral reforms we need to go through? The first reform that I would like to suggest is to change the existing first-past-post system. Under this system, if a person gets more than one vote more than the others, he gets elected. Let us assume a constituency of 100,000. Let us assume 10 candidates contesting the elections. A person getting, let us assume all the people get more or less equal number of votes. The person who gets 10,001 vote is declared elected over the person who has got 10,000 votes. Is this system really democratic? It is all right when we got independence, when universal franchise was proudly announced by Jawaharlal Nehru, the Constituent Assembly. It is all right that we had the first-past-post system. But today, this has resulted in dangerous consequences. There are parties formed on the basis of caste, sub-caste, community. They are able to have representatives in two or three constituencies. In a scenario of coalition government, they are able to dictate terms to the parties that they should not only be part of the coalition system, but also they should be given ministerial berths. I don't have to give you individual cases. All of you know that these small parties with very narrow outlook, they want to dominate the national scene. Is that desirable? You have many alternatives to this system. One of the alternatives is to introduce proportional representation. The other is a list system where you do not elect an individual, you elect a series of individuals. And the people are given differential votes, they can vote first preference, second preference, and so on. There is another system where you can insist on a person getting 50% of the votes poll alone should be declared elected, 50% plus one vote. This is again prevalent in many countries. Then we have many other alternatives, the mixed system, whether it is in Germany or Palestine. They have 50% of the representatives elected on a normal geographical constituency representation principle. The remaining 50% are elected nationally or on the basis of proportional representation. So my first important suggestion for electoral reform, if you want to improve the quality of democracy in India, is that we should do away with the first-past-post system. The second thing that I would like to stress is the need to regulate political parties. Justice Venkatacharya was the head of a constitution review committee. One of the recommendations made by him, in fact, the suggestion was made by the election commission, and they supported it, that we should have a separate law for political parties. The law should detail the conditions required for political parties to be formed, the way in which they function, the way in which they receive funds, the way in which they maintain their amounts, the way in which they will conduct the internal democratic elections, and if there is a dispute, how will they resolve it. At the moment, we do not have any such law. In fact, many of you may be surprised to know, until the anti-defection law, the political parties did not figure in our constitution of India. Be that as it may, it is absolutely necessary for us to regulate these political parties, because today we have more than 800 political parties registered. Hardly 40 or 50 of them really get into the business of elections and get elected. The remaining are used for various questionable purposes. They become lobby leaders, they become instruments of converting black money into white money, and so on. So it is, in my opinion, the second important change that we should have is to bring about this regulation of political parties. At the moment, what we do in the election commission is to prescribe certain conditions for registration. We don't have the power to deregister the political parties. The only method by which we can control the political party is through the symbols, political or election symbols order. The symbols order has been approved by the Supreme Court, was formulated by the election commission itself. That we have said, if the political parties behave in an unconstitutional manner or in a manner that is detrimental to the conduct of free and fair elections, we can re-recognize the symbols. Now, you must have recently heard of what happened in Uttar Pradesh, where certain statues were ordered to be covered because they happened to be close to the symbols of the political parties. Some people thought it was a very idiotic order of the government or the election commission to cover all these elements because it represented the symbol of a political party. Now, it is a debatable issue. I am not saying that it's the right course to do or it's the wrong course to do. But what I want to say is, if the symbol is exploited by political parties in the taxpayers' money, you must have the right to withdraw the symbol. This is what I mentioned when the TVC asked me, how do we get over this difficulty? The simple order should have a provision by which, if taxpayers' money is used to propagate the symbol of their particular political party, you must have the right to withdraw the symbol. So we have such powers to control and regulate political parties, but they are not adequate. One of the things that we have come across in the model code of conduct, where it is not a legislation, it is a code of conduct evolved with the consensus of all political parties to ensure that there is a level playing field for all the political parties and the candidates contesting the elections. Unfortunately, since it is a code of conduct, it has no legislative backup, and the election commission cannot take legal action except to warn or to introduce certain measures by which the damage done by the party is recompensated to the government. I'll give you one example. The chief minister of one state traveled by a state helicopter to the border of his state to canvass for each political party in the adjacent border state or border district. The question arose whether we should take action against the chief minister or not. So we issued a show cause notice. He claimed that he had got some official work in each state and the border district. And then only thereafter we moved on to the border district of the other state. But we had to intervene because it was a dressed up transaction. We had to tell, repay the entire cost of the expenditure incurred to the state treasury back to the government so that you do not take undue advantage of your position as a chief minister. There are a number of many such instances where Morocco violations were dealt with. But in spite of that, you saw in recent elections how even responsible ministers behave irresponsibly. So one of the suggestions I would go to suggest, one of the good many is whether the model code of conduct can be given a legislative shape on one condition, that if there is any violation of the model code of conduct, the election commission should have the power to convict a person with either a fine or disqualification. It will apply to not only to political parties but also to candidates contesting elections. So this is again one of the reforms we have been suggesting. The fourth suggestion I would like to make is the right to recall the representative. Unfortunately, there is again a divided opinion about recalling elected representatives because they think that once they are appointed, they should have the freedom to function in the next election, they should be either rewarded or penalized for their performance. Considering the fact that the political party are not nominating good candidates, the right to recall will force them to perform better. I do agree that we should give a reasonable time to perform in the legislatures. I would say if for 2.5 years, at least 50% of the tenure of the House, after the end of the 2.5 years, if the person is found to be wanting in his performance, particularly in matters related to his personal conduct, like personal misdemeanor or corruption, the voters should have the right to suggest that the voters would like to consider whether it should be recalled or not. Again, this system is existent in many countries. My good friend, the present Chief Election Commissioner, Mr. Qureshi, doesn't seem to agree with his view because he has reasons why it should not be introduced because it's difficult to implement and so on, and then the legislators should have the freedom to perform for the whole period of 5 years and the voters will decide. Certainly, I would agree with his view provided if you have good representatives in the legislatures. When the legislatures are elected on the basis of caste, community and so on, or money power of that person, how can we ensure that these persons will perform well? I will give them reasonable time. First 2.5 years, let them show their performance by asking questions, by asking bills which need to be introduced in the House and so on. If after 2 candidates, when I have received the system, introduce a button in the electronic voting scheme suggesting that if you are not satisfied with any candidate put up by any political party, or then by all the political parties, including the independents, you should have the right to register with a protest vote saying that I do not like any of the persons. The political party is the other candidates, even if they maximum votes, they forfeit the right to represent the constituency. Let us assume the constituency has got more than 90,000 people who don't like him at all. So this is again a suggestion which has been made. The election ballot pro forma does not mention this option and the whole election is void, in which case the entire election would have been a waste of exercise. So we thought we should not encourage this practice. And many political parties seem to think that they can win over sectional interests by appealing to these interests to vote for them, where the voting vote bank is probably weak. The question is, if you provide a public good, you can mention it in the manifesto, I want to build a dam, I want to build a road, I want to build a stadium, and so on. These are public goods. In what we call the economic public goods. But if you say I will give television to those people who are having ration card holders, you are influencing the vote. Is that correct? Besides, when you put it in the manifesto, you are incurring a budget, you are committing yourself to a budget expense. expenditure which has not been voted by the parliament or the legislature. So you are intervening in certain exercises which are not conducive to good politics. So it must, the law as and when it is amended, should clearly say the manifesto should be of a general nature. It can provide public goods but not private goods. This is again a very important suggestion which we need to consider. Another important, I have more than 10-15, but I will not go beyond 5 or 6 because of the positive time. Maybe if you want to have a reaction time for 15-20 minutes, I don't mind answering the questions. The legal criminalization of politics. Now, many contestants nominated with the political parties are persons with a record of criminal allegations. They are not convicted, but there are allegations against them of very serious offenses. Now, in India, a person to get convicted, it takes 10 years in the trial court. Then to get it confirmed or affirmed or acquitted, it takes another 10 years and then goes up to the Supreme Court. In some countries, there are only 2 layers of appeal. Here we have the Sessions Court, the High Court, and the Supreme Court. Whether it is not desirable to prevent people where the prima facie evidence of criminal offense, whether they should be disqualified. But there are arguments both for and against, because some of the political parties say that just before the elections, the ruling party will foist unjustified cases against their enemies in other parties, so that they don't, then they will get disqualified when they don't contest the elections. We have given a workable solution to this. He said, we do not want people who have committed minor offences to be disqualified. Only offences where they are punishable with 5 years of imprisonment and more. Such persons should be disqualified. One more condition. That the court framed a prima facie charge against the person. Now, this is not merely an FIR being registered by a political party and then you disqualify a person. Certainly not. What we are suggesting is, let the court, in its wisdom, if it frames a charge sheet against a person of serious offences, punishable with 5 years of imprisonment and so on, they may be disqualified. Third condition we have suggested is, all right, you say it's during the election time that such bogus cases may be foisted with the ruling party. What I suggested is that any such cases where the court has framed prima facie charges 1 year before the day of announcement of election, they may be disqualified. But all the political parties do not want this amendment. The reason being, they say that some of these people are very innocent, they are being penalized, they are being denied the right to contest the elections. Let me tell you, the right to contest the election is not a fundamental right. It is only a statutory right under the Representation of People's Act. The government servant, when he is found to have indulged in a misdemeanor, he is suspended. And he takes some subsistence allowance. And then, if he is found to be honest, he is reinstated, he gets back all his pay. If he is convicted, whatever punishment is imposed, and then he has the right to appeal, and so on. It's a statutory right, he has to employment. Similarly, statutory right to contest election can be temporarily suspended. There is no violation of fundamental right. And all that we are saying is that for a period of 5 years, or whatever it is, that please, charges are decided upon, it should not represent the people. I see no reason why government should not bring about this amendment in law. At the moment, unless a person is convicted, and convicted, suppose the High Court suspends the conviction, then he or she can still contest the election. We have one or two cases like that. So unless the law is amended, we will continue to have criminally sensitive people in our parliament. Are they desirable to legislate for you and me? This is the question that I would like to pose. The government of India, well, whatever be the party, they have been writing to them, there is no response. The main reason given for not bringing about some of the important electoral reforms is that there is no consensus among political parties. When what you are suggesting is going to affect them, how will there be consensus? What you should do, if you have a majority, if you are convinced that these measures are necessary in the long-term interest of this country, you should go ahead, and the parliament has the right to pass a law with its majority. There is no need for two-thirds majority. So such important changes need to be addressed seriously, and they cannot be brushed aside under the carpet, or we have to wait for Supreme Court direction to be given to bring about these changes. Well, some initiative has been shown by the Bharat government by holding some periodical seminars and so on. And the minister recently in a seminar in about 15 days back in Delhi said that the draft amendment bill is ready, and then it will be introduced probably in the next session of the parliament. This is what I told him. He may not be able to give you Bharat Ratna, but we would certainly applaud you that you have done an important national duty to cleanse the quality of political life in this country. My fear is that if you do not take important changes to be brought about immediately, our democracy is in terrible danger. You have already seen the consequences, how much of corruption is prevalent. They are not willing to bring about the anti-corruption law. Whatever we have heard so far is a diluted form of the bill is supposed to be coming. Be that as it may, I am not going into the debate of weak law or strong law. The leaders should realize that if the posterity has to thank us, it is necessary for us to take stern and firm action. Otherwise, we will end up like countries like Thailand, like Syria, like Egypt, because educated youth, they will not keep quiet if you are not going to bring about good governance. If incompetent people in government are going to condone misgovernance, I am afraid it is a danger signal to the quality of democracy. John Key, a professor in one of the UK universities, has written a book called The Life and Death of Democracy. In that he says, many people seem to think that they have achieved a very high degree of democratic functioning. But unfortunately, in almost every country, including the advanced countries, advanced Western countries, there are many undemocratic features which need to be corrected. Electoral reform is the call of the hour, not only for India, but all countries. If you want to respect the sentiments, feelings and wishes of the people, and if you do not, the consequence is staggering. It is going to be more violent. If Moïse are successful in some of these places, it is again because of misgovernance. If voters are boycotting the elections, again, it is the consequence of bad governance. The political parties should realize the dangerous signals that are happening. Now it's only in 3 or 4 states or 5 states you have the Naxalite violence. We invite such most undesirable activities in other states. It is one thing to tackle violence and discontent of the people by addressing the problems related in that section, but when it becomes a national problem, it will be very difficult to justify, it will be very difficult to tackle the problem. When it goes beyond your hand, you will find that the whole unity of this country is in danger. If you want to avoid the consequence of what happened in USSR, if you want to protect and preserve the unity of this country, if you want to enjoy the benefit of a huge common market in the country, if you preserve the good quality of life and good governance in this country. There's another in me for reforms.
Talk about what Sri Aurobindo said about our politicians, about our representatives. He says, our representative does not represent the soul of the people or its aspirations. What he does usually represent is all the average pettiness, selfishness, egoism, self-deception that is about him and those he represents well enough, as well as a great deal of mental incompetence, timidity, and pretense. Great issues often come to him for decision, but he does not deal with them greatly. High words and noble ideas are on his lips, but they become rapidly the claptrap of a party. This is about 40, 50 years ago, back, a statement made about politicians in India. And you can now imagine what they would have said if they had been alive to see the quality of many of our politicians. Now the problem is, I hope I have another 5 minutes. The problem is corruption is increasing, and the question is whether political corruption needs to be tackled first or bureaucratic corruption needs to be tackled first. In my opinion, political corruption is paving the way for all kinds of corruption. There is corruption not only in government, there is corruption in non-governmental organizations, there is corruption among the politicians, there is corruption among the bureaucrats, there is corruption even in the private sector. But the only difference between the governmental corruption and the non-governmental corruption is that taxpayers' money is being wasted and taxpayer does not get good governance as a result. So the more important question we have addressed today is the governmental corruption. But that doesn't mean the non-governmental corruption can be ignored. There are a number of civil society organizations which are coming to existence in recent time, and they are doing a wonderful job. And they have started asking questions to the government. The Right to Information Act has become a very important tool to check corruption. But then there are so many infirmities. I know of bureaucrats who consult ministers before writing their notes in the files. I know of bureaucrats who used to challenge the minister face to face, saying that what you want to do is wrong. Now, in a government system, the bureaucrat can challenge the minister and he can survive because your rights are justiciable. In a non-governmental organization, if you question, you will lose your job. In the government, you may be transferred to an insignificant post. You may not be given the kind of city life that you want to have. But then, I can tell you without any hesitation, I am proud of having been in the government because I could stand up and tell the minister he is wrong. And we could tell them, it is not difficult at all. There are many officers. In Bihar, there was one IPS officer. There was an IAS officer who stood up for the rights. And in fact, I wrote a personal complimentary letter to them and placed them on the confidential record. There are a number of such officers and officers. Unfortunately, they are not being led properly. See, there are some who have the mental strength to face the consequences. This particular officer in Bihar, I thank him. He barred a member of parliament entering his constituency on the election day. So I called him on the phone and said, you should not have done that. You are denying him the right to vote. You can debar, I have no problem. But his right to vote cannot be denied. You know what he said? Sir, under the Bihar Control of Offences Act, the collector has got the right to prevent any undesirable element coming into the constituency. And I, in my judgment, I have come to this conclusion, he is undesirable. In fact, he is undesirable in my opinion as well. But we could not take that kind of a tough stand. He took it and he told me, sir, I am willing to face the consequences.
I will prevent this man because he is responsible for many misdeeds during election time. There was another police officer from Andhra Pradesh, but working in Bihar. She was risking her life to prevent chaos in the election booths. She could immediately arrest some political leaders who were contributing to violence. So we need not be afraid or we need not be worried. My message to young people is, join government service. You can certainly distinguish yourself very well. You can certainly assert your authority. In our astrology, they say people who enter government service, they have Raja Yoga. That Raja Yoga is not for misuse. Raja Yoga is for youth. You will contribute to the welfare of the society. People will be ever grateful. I can show you any number of letters we have received from Bihar that the first violence-free election we conducted in 2004. And we had countermanded the election of the chief minister because there were allegations and there were violations. And it became a big news. Then we went and reported to the prison as to how we came.